A beautiful morning to each and every one of you. Welcome to Maranatha Baptist Church. And also, I'd like to welcome our first-time visitors this morning. Let's begin. Let's all stand as we sing our first hymn on hymn 66. To God be the glory, 66. Let's continue singing on the last verse of hymn 66.
Sunday morning. All right, some of you may think you're sleeping in, but you're actually here in church. Praise the Lord. What a blessing. Brother Daniel, come on down here and open us up in prayer, sir.
Good morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I'm thankful to be here this morning, and I ask, Lord, that your blessings would be upon our services. I pray that you'd fill Pastor Miller with your spirit. Lord, give him wisdom, Lord, and help us to understand the message. I pray, Father, for everyone that is here, that whatever they're going through, Lord, that they'll set aside and cast all their cares upon you, Lord. For the Bible says that you care for us, Lord, and I'm thankful that you're a God that cares, and I'm thankful that you're a God who hears, Lord, and answers prayer. I ask, Lord, for your blessings this morning in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's all be seated. Well, it's sure good to see you back. You know, it's always encouraging for the pastor, after we've had some really great meetings, for people to show up the next Sunday. Amen? Amen. And so it's sure good to see you guys back out tonight or today. Well, I'll tell you what, it's been so long since I preached, I don't even know the difference between night and day. But I'll tell you, how many enjoyed those meetings that we had with Brother Dwight? What a blessing. What a blessing. So thankful. And we want to continue that momentum. Amen? Revival is about an ongoing, continual work in you. And so it's not about scheduling a meeting. It's about our growing in our walk and relationship with the Lord, for sure. I'll tell you, you can't forget Dwight, though, because when I walked up on the platform this morning for Sunday school, there sat right over here that, what is that thing that he plays? Accordion. I know what that is because my dad used to play one by ear. And there was his accordion sitting right there. So, you know, he's over in the big city of Edinburgh without his accordion. So I was thinking about taking a picture and putting it on Facebook, me playing it. But we'll just, I'm sure I'll be hearing from him. Hey, if anybody's headed back to Edinburgh and you want to be a nice, good friend, you can... maybe we can work it out so you can drop off the accordion to the evangelist. Amen. I'm sure they would be happy to have it tonight. Amen. But we're happy that you're here. And, okay, I've already got an Edinburgh resident, Ms. Sister Cappy and Brother Benny. Well, wait. Now, you're not in Benny's car because that won't fit in Benny's car. Okay? Okay, you're in the big car. Good, good. Okay, so that'll work. That'll work. All right, so that important business is already taken care of. Now let's do some more important business. Let's welcome visitors. Do we have anyone that has someone that you would like to introduce? Anybody here? Any introductions at all? At all? Well, that means that we're all folks that have either been here before or we don't care about you. That's I'm sure that's not the case, but if we yes, we do. We do have two new choir members. That's right. That's right. Alan and Jose. Amen. What a blessing. I don't think of them as new because they were there during the revival. So it's such a blessing to have these guys. All right. Well, let's share a few announcements and we'll continue with the service. Notice, there aren't a lot. So here you go. Awana resumes this Wednesday at 6:30. If you feel God may be leading you to help in this ministry, see, we can still get, we would still like help. See the commander right over there, Commander Ralph Garza, and he'll put you to work for sure. And fellowship committee meeting next Sunday, we will be having a fellowship committee meeting. So please, if you're a member of the fellowship committee, please make plans to attend. Amen. We want to make sure we take care of business and that they are up and running and have a new chairperson or whoever they call. And so we need to have that meeting for sure. We want to also utilize this important group, and we're thankful for the ministry of the fellowship committee. Amen. All right. Any other announcements? Okay.
Let's turn to him. 220. He lives. 220.
tonight, you know how wonderful it was. And every time that the preacher preached and that Brother Doyle led us in a song, it always was because God is so good. And our song this morning is God is so good. So please, he's good all the time.
Amen.
Stand one more time, please, and let's turn to hymn 433, Sweet Hour of Prayer, 433.
amen. Brother Tommy, grab that microphone, would you, and look to the Lord for us, sir. We need it for them. You're a celebrity, okay? We just need you to do that.
Is it on? Hello.
He's got it back there.
Okay. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be here in your house, Father. We ask you, Lord, to be with Pastor. Open up our minds, prepare our hearts to hear from you, Father. Now, Lord, as we pick up this offering, we ask you to bless it in a mighty way and bless those that give. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see.
Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appeared the hour I first
My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. Like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love. Amazing grace. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, reigns, unending love, amazing grace. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
Amen. What a blessing. That's wonderful. Let's dismiss our kids now.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong, they are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, oh yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus me, for the Bible tells me so.
Amen, amen. What a blessing. Thankful for our musicians, thankful for our all of those that sing special music. What a blessing all of you are. You truly are. And just as Brother Doyle said, there's still room on the platform for a few more instruments, a few more people in the choir. Amen. Let me think. This is called putting you on the spot. Are you ready? Sister Janelle already told me she's going to dust off that trumpet that she has in the. And so we hope to see that very soon. Amen. Make sure every one of you walk up and tell her, amen, we're looking forward to it, amen? All right. What a blessing, what a blessing. I would invite you to turn in your Bibles this morning to Ephesians chapter 6. Have you ever heard anybody preach from Ephesians chapter 6? About in Sunday school this morning and for several other times over the last few weeks, we have been talking about putting on the whole armor of God. And we're gonna preach, Lord willing, one more message to finish this series. And I got to tell you, what a great study, what a great undertaking it is to just really expand and break down this important work of putting on the whole armor of God. Please notice Ephesians chapter 6. And let's read again one more time, verse 10, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand, therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation. That was Sunday school this morning, by the way.
and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints, and for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. Amen. Father, we do thank you and we love you and we praise you this morning. Lord, we thank you already for what you're doing, as I believe you're moving in hearts even now and minds, even as we talked about this morning in Sunday school. Help this preacher even now to hide behind the cross. Let people hear exactly what you would have them to hear. And have your way with each and every one of us. Lord, yes, if there's even one here this morning who does not know Jesus Christ as their Savior, friend, today is the day you need to trust Jesus. You need to get saved. Don't walk away from this place without knowing for sure that if you die today, you're going to heaven. Speak to hearts, we pray, in Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Notice again, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17. Sunday school started out with this very important piece of armor. And take the helmet of salvation. That was Sunday school. We talked about the helmet of salvation. And Lord willing, this morning, notice the rest of the verse. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Amen? The sword of the Spirit. The sword of the Spirit. The Christian life is a struggle from beginning to end. How many would agree with that? Amen? If you haven't been struggling, let me put it this way. There's no real either to it. If you're born again and you're a problem at all for Satan, if he's concerned even a little bit about you, there ought to be some struggle. There, yes, is victory, but there is continual struggle. Satan is not happy with you. We have a battle to fight. And it's called evil. For some in this world today, they don't even like you to use that language. Oh, nobody's evil. Nobody. People just have different thought patterns, different ways of looking at things. That's where you get disgusting ideas like pedophilia is okay and other kinds of disgusting things, right? You know, if you don't think that this world is evil, well, I'll tell you, you just need to just take a good close look at just the mindset and the attitude of people today. You know, we have people that are out marching and you know, it's absolutely right and appropriate to be able to protest. But when signs are so wicked and vile and filthy that they can't even show them on TV, it kind of tells you the mindset and the heart of the world that we live in today. I got to tell you, we live in an evil world. And you know what? Satan is seductive. You know, sin isn't something that people need to be talked into. They need to be talked out of it because it's so appealing. It's pleasurable for a season. And that goes for the born-again Christian. The one who doesn't put on the whole armor of God will struggle. I can guarantee you there will be more defeats than victories. And I'll tell you what, after this week, I hope that we just resolve in our hearts not to be apathetic about our faith. You know, That's really what revival is all about. Amen? We use the word revival, and you know, we got to be careful. Sometimes we get so used to a word, we just think that, oh, that's what you call meetings when you have an evangelist come. I'll tell you what we're battling, folks, is apathy. Apathy. It is not the wicked in the world that we need to worry about. It's the apathetic Christians who don't care. Who just seem to think that, hey, look, it's just the way things are, and let's just continue to cruise along and, you know, live life as usual. I hope that you'll join me and say, Lord, help me. Help me not to just settle for complacency. Help me not to just be happy with, you know, the norm. Hey, don't you want to not be considered a normal Christian? I mean, don't you want somebody to say, they're not normal? And I'll tell you, one thing for sure, we preachers, we pastors, we always want for our folks to fight off apathy, to fight off just, you know, settling back in and just going with the flow. It's a challenge that has to be an ongoing, continual challenge. I remember when Dwight was saying, yeah, you know, you hear the preacher, the message that he preached on what to do if you don't want to grow, right? What to do if you don't want to see revival, you know? How do you disregard the preacher preaching on walking in the Spirit and not in the flesh? How do you fight these kinds of things? Well, the real truth is we all know how easy it is to resist the Lord, how easy it is to just fight off this idea that we're not going to accept things the way they are, that we're going to want to say, you know, putting on the whole armor of God is all about getting ready to fight the enemy every day. And here's where we make the mistake. We think that, well, listen, I'm not going to fight the enemy today, so therefore I don't need the whole armor of God. Yes, you do. Just like we talked about in Sunday school, the helmet of salvation, walking in the fact that you're born again. If you hop on a motorcycle and you go tearing out across, the expressway, and you don't have a helmet on, you're living very dangerously. And when we walk out into this world without putting on the whole armor of God, we are making a huge mistake. And you know, the more we put on the whole armor of God, the more we need to put on the whole armor of God. What do I mean by that? When Satan gets a clue that you're for real, that he's somebody that you've caused him to be worried about, then you better even now for sure. Let's say you stepped up and said, you know what, family, we're going to do devotions. You know what, family, we're going to pray together. And it's not going to be just praying over that meal. Amen? Last night we were praying over the meal, and I'll tell you, just like I always did when I was little, sometimes the little ones will be smelling that food and looking at that food and tasting it, and they just can't wait till that prayer's over. Amen? Don't act like that's never happened to you. But we need to pray. We need to do these things. We've been looking at various pieces of armor that we must utilize in the battle against evil for good. Paul uses pieces of armor to make a spiritual application to the life and ministry of Jesus' followers and points out the necessity of putting on the whole armor of God. It's vital that we wear the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the sandals of readiness to do God's will, and the helmet of salvation. We must also carry the sword of the Spirit. And what is the sword of the Spirit? It says right here in the scripture, doesn't it? Which is the Word of God. You know, in my office, I have a few. I have a whole lot of stuff. You know what? If you're a kid, you love the pastor's office. I've got the coolest office. I've got airplanes and churches and stuff on my desk. Ask any kid. Ask my grandkids. They know. First thing they like to mess with is I have a few different letter openers. And I've got one that looks like a sword. And if you're four, it is a sword, amen? And so, you know, I've got to say, no, 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 don't touch that. Don't stab your brother. Put it back. And then I love the way they try to explain that it's okay, you know? I mean, you know, but Grandpa, it's a sword. It's a letter opener, okay? The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. We should use this wonderful tool to attack. I'm talking about be on offense and fight the enemy. That's what the Word of God is all about. That's why we don't just say this because it sounds like what we're supposed to say. We are a Bible-believing church. You know how many, even when we go out door knocking, tell us, well, that's one of the problems that we have with you. You guys place too much emphasis, are you ready, on the Word of God. Boy, those are the kind of complaints that I like to hear, amen? Amen. Say that to me all day long. You see, God has given His children what they need for successfully waging warfare. I got to tell you, folks, are you ready to fight? The first great truth Paul emphasizes in this text is that God has given us the Holy Spirit to dwell within us. We preach a lot on the Holy Spirit around here. We understand that if you're not a Spirit-filled Christian, if you're not walking in the Spirit, you will see a lot of defeat. The tool that the Holy Spirit uses to accomplish God's purposes is God's Word. The Christian without God's Word is without. It's like having a magazine that's empty, no ammo. For us to neglect or to ignore the teachings of the Word of God in our daily life would be as foolish as it would be for a soldier to depart for battle without taking his weapons with him. That's why I believe the Lord chose to end with really where it all begins, with the Word of God. And let's just take a good look at how important God's Word is. Can we do that this morning? Notice, first of all, number one, Joshua and the way to success. Notice with me Joshua chapter 1, Joshua chapter 1, verse 8. This book of the law, and by the way, the book of the law is the Word of God, amen. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, and that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. Well, you could just preach this verse right here. And then thou shalt make thy way prosperous. And then thou shalt have good success. Now, from the Old Testament to the New Testament, we're reminded of the significance of this sword right here. Some of you say, well, my sword is on my cell phone. I've seen a couple of people say, Should we ever, you know, look at Bible apps on cell phones? I think you should look at Bible apps. The problem is the other things that we look at on our cell phones. Amen? So we need to be careful about the distractions. One thing about it, there are no ads in this book. Amen? There are no distractions. When Joshua took over the leadership of the 12 tribes of Israel, he was informed that he would find the way of success and that his leadership would prosper only as he gave daily attention to God's law. He was to meditate on the book of the law both day and night and follow its teachings carefully. Leadership, listen. If you're not meditating on the Word of God day and night, you're not a leader. Can I just say that again? I'm talking about everybody. If you're not meditating on the Word of God day and night, you're not fulfilling your call. He was promised prosperity and success as he gave attention to God's Word. You focus on God's Word and you'll get prosperity and success, but it'll be God's prosperity, God's success, not the world's idea of what prosperity and success is. You want to know what prosperity is? When you share the good news of Jesus Christ and someone says yes to Jesus while you sit on the front row as the Holy Spirit speaks to them, amen? God's counsel to Joshua is still meaningful and true for now, for the present. Are you equipped like Joshua? Do you understand to be called to serve, to be one who is to lead? You must take hold of the sword of the Spirit or the sword of the Lord, the Word of God. Secondly, the psalmist points the way to happiness. Notice Psalm chapter 1. And for those of you who are looking at the Bible for the first time, that would be Psalm chapter 1. Psalm chapter 1, we love this verse, don't we? Look at these, just the first few verses. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. What does verse 2 say? Listen. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doth shall prosper. I mean, what a great verse. I mean, I think these are some of the verses that all Awana kids learn. Isn't it a blessing to hear these kids? Aren't you amazed when you see somebody who's only been on this planet for a few short years stand up and quote more verses than you have even memorized your whole life? Wasn't it Adair who stood up here and, what, I think she quoted the Bible one day? And we're all following along, like, that's right. Oh, by the way, it was a real blessing, too, because when she did it with just her enthusiasm and her demeanor was so moving, so wonderful. That's my little plug for we sure hope to see her again someday. Amen. The psalmist describes the man who is both happy and successful as one who avoids the ways of the wicked and who delights in the law of the Lord both, here it is, both day and night. You think, you know, I'm so glad if I can get to my Bible every once in a while, day and night. The man who so fills his mind and heart with the great truths of God is likened to a tree planted by a river. Its leaf never withers, and it prospers in its way. There is no way a Christian can experience happiness and success if he or she neglects the clear teachings of God's Word. If you're just living on, are you ready? A Sunday morning service every once in a while, I guarantee you, you're going to have more defeats than victories. If it's all about whether or not the preacher entertained you enough or engaged you enough, you didn't come hungry. Those who are in God's Word always get more out of anything that the preacher does. That I just tell you right now. I mean, that's just the truth. Thirdly, our Lord and His victory over Satan. I love these passages. Turn to Matthew with me. Matthew chapter 4. What an amazing, amazing encounter. Let's notice Matthew chapter 4, these first few verses here. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. Now, did that really happen? Yes, that happened, of course. That's exactly what happened. I answered before you could even answer. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, I love this verse. This is one of my favorite verses in all the Bible. He was an hungered. Okay, let me just, in case you didn't know that, if you fast for 40 days and 40 nights, you will be hungry. Amen? And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city and sitteth him on a pinnacle of the temple and saith unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written. By the way, who's quoting scripture now? The devil. For it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. And then what does Jesus do? Jesus said unto him, what does he say? It is written. Hey, Matt, can I just, are you ready? You can't say it is written if you don't know it is written. You know what we mostly say? You know, the Church of the Ignorant Brethren. Well, I think it says somewhere in the Bible. Or doesn't it say, wait, doesn't it say somewhere? No. It is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. I got to tell you, I just felt like there must have been a roaring sound of the Lord's voice in his response to Satan. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and saith unto him, all these things I give thee. Boy, what a deceiver. What a liar. All these things I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. How many have read this and thought, how can this even happen? This all took place for your learning. Notice verse 10. Then saith Jesus unto him. How about this? Have you ever said this to someone? Get thee hence, Satan, for it is written. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only thou shalt serve. Some of us need to remember that verse next time Satan attacks us. And then notice, then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. Isn't that exactly what we want? Isn't that exactly what we should be doing? Isn't this our standard right here? I got to tell you something. You're not reading the Word of God just because, oh, you know what? I'm a Christian. It's kind of required. Somebody might even ask, and I better say I did. My friend, if you're not able to say it is written, when the enemy attacks, because I'll tell you, the real problem is Satan knows way more scripture than you do. And he'll, you know, you think he doesn't use scripture to confound you? If he'll do it to the Lord, don't you think he'll go after you? The Jehovah's Witnesses, that's what they call themselves. That's not what they are. They have a book called Reasoning the Scriptures. I had a friend who had a copy of those, of that book. And it got him so crazy, I told him he needed to throw it away. Because it was so corrupted and so full of lies and so mesmerizing in the way it would twist scripture, it would mess with your head. And that's what the enemy does. Are you hearing me? That's what the enemy does. He doesn't come along and you know, in some inadequate, inept way, challenge you. No, he knows what he's doing. Do you? Notice, fourthly, this is all about the Word of God this morning, isn't it? The function of the Holy Scriptures, and I say this with reverence. You know, I'm a little weary, and I'm getting just kind of tired of us being so casual about Scripture, okay? Can I just say that? Can I tell you that there's nothing casual or just, no, I'm looking for another word that I can't even come up with. There's nothing but reverence and love and devotion that ought to be poured on Scripture. I mean, this is God breathing. That's why we use words like, and I know some people have hijacked words like holy and sacred, and oh, it sounds liturgical, and people get kind of weird about that. Some of us Baptists don't even like those words, but you know what? The Word of God is sacred. It is holy. The sacred writings reveal the nature of God and the way of salvation through Christ. Remember, this is the gospel of peace. 2 Timothy 3:15. And what a verse, what a great verse. And that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. It's the Word of God that saves, amen? You know, if we don't get anything else out of this morning, can we get back to reverencing the Scripture? That we recognize Scripture as sacred? You know, I know that the direction has been, let's make everything about Christianity more and more like the world, more and more casual, more and more crass, if you ask me. You know what you get when you get people who don't regard the Scripture as sacred and don't recognize the significance of Scripture? You get casual, crass speaking and preaching. You get casual and crass music. The sacred Scriptures provide authoritative guidance for conduct that is pleasing to God. Here's that other great verse that we all love. Are you ready? 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. All Scripture. I need some help here. What does all mean? All means all. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine. Ooh, there's that word. I've actually heard, not anybody here, but people who call themselves Christians say, I get so tired of everybody talking about doctrine all the time. You know, we'd all get along a lot better, hey, if it wasn't all about doctrine. I mean, can't we just say we love Jesus? You know, Ephesians chapter 4 is all about standing on what brings us together is doctrine, is teaching. It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Man, I'll tell you what, it's all there for us, right? First of all, profitable for what? Teaching. Some people say, well, what's your best Sunday school curriculum? Right here. Right here. Now, we use good Sunday school curriculum that honors this book. That's the way it'll always be. I can tell you, as long as this crowd's here and this pastor's here, that's the way it'll always be at Maranatha Baptist Church. We believe that the Word of God is profitable for teaching. You want to know what this world needs? They need to be taught. First, they need to be taught that they're a sinner in need of a Savior. They need to be taught that Jesus loves them. They need to be taught. You're the teacher. They're the student. Hey, parents, are you ready? Newsflash, you're the parents and they're the children.
Well, we don't really want to, you know, we don't want to force anything.
Isn't it amazing we force people to walk into certain bathrooms today, but we don't want to force the Word of God on anybody, right? And then profitable for reproof. Some people think that's the only word that Christians know. That's that mean word, reproof. The reproof is for me. When I read this book, I should be reproved. Amen? Amen? And then how about, and by the way, when you're reproved, what happens then next? The Word of God is profitable for correction. You see, it's one thing to say, okay, I'm wrong. It's another thing to do something about it. You see, we believe that this book can change the direction of a marriage. Amen? We believe this book can change the direction of a young person who's headed in the right in the wrong direction. We believe that this book can correct. This book must correct me. This book must correct you. And then, of course, when you're receiving teaching, you're accepting reproof, you're allowing for correction, here's what happens. This book is profitable for instruction Now, that sounds like teaching, but watch this. Instruction in what? In righteousness. That's right. Can I ask you a question? Do you want to be further along in your walk and relationship with the Lord tomorrow than you are today? Do you want more than just a cavalier, mundane, no big deal, blasé relationship? Is that what you want? Are you willing to accept less than what God has for you? Well, the real truth is, no matter how I might plead or beg, only if you make up your mind that this book matters more to you than life, only that way will you see continued revival, which is putting off apathy. The sacred scriptures, and I say sacred, the sacred scriptures equip the receptive and responsive believer for fruitful service. You see, all of this doesn't matter if all you are you ready? If all you are is a Christian consumer. That's our mentality today, right? We're all about consuming. That's what I do when you invite me to lunch, amen? I consume. But you see, we're supposed to take what now the Lord is doing and now use it. And if we're not witnessing, if we're not discipling, we're not doing anything more than just simply consuming. We're to serve. Notice verse 17, 2 Timothy 3:17 says, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto what? All, there it is right there. Some people don't like this in this super grace age, they call themselves. It says, furnished unto all good works. Hey, did you know that we as Christians ought to, are you ready? We ought to have good works. So let's close with this. Here are some suggestions for how you might use the sword of the Spirit for God's glory. Are you ready? Read the Word of God daily. Read the Word of God daily. Set aside time in your schedule. If you've got to put it on your phone, put it on your phone to read the Word of God. As you read, listen intently for God speaking to you. And may I say this also to you preachers out there? You better make sure that there's personal devotion time, not just preparation time. God needs to be speaking to you. Pray the Word of God into your heart. Ask God for guidance and help that you might understand it. Thy word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Obey the great truths of God's word reverently and regularly. Take seriously the Word of God. Whenever somebody comes to me, I always ask this question. How much importance do you place on the Word of God? If you're born again, how much importance do you place on the Word of God? If you don't place much importance, we're kind of wasting our time talking. That's what we need to be talking about. Because what counsel is about is the Word of God. And hey, may we all remember that, by the way, when you're counseling somebody on the phone, quit giving them your personal life and start giving them the Word of God. Amen? You do a disservice as a born-again Christian when you don't stick to God's Word when it comes to discipling and helping others. That's the truth. Look for the promises to claim in the Word of God. It really is true. Every promise is true, and every promise is for you. Look for commandments to obey. Some people think, well, you're talking about the Ten Commandments. Can I tell you, the Bible from Genesis to Revelation is full of commandments and precepts. Look for examples to follow. When people join Operation Go, we don't just show them four verses and say, now go out and, you know, win people to Christ. We want them to learn from the Bible how other people got saved and how other people shared the gospel. Those are our examples. And in every area of our life as Christians, look for examples to follow. And how about this? You know, how many people know of people in their lives that have made an impact on them? I hope we all can say, yeah. Well, none of you, anyway. I have. Can I just say this? Some of the people that I love the most, that have taught me the most, also have helped me to learn from their mistakes. You say, well, thank you, preacher, because I've learned a lot from your mistakes. Thank you, brother. Thank you. But the real truth is that ought to be the case. Hey, amen? Look for sins to forsake and avoid. I'm not saying that you ought to be calling out somebody and say, oh, heck yeah. No. Look in the scriptures for sins to forsake and avoid. I think it's amazing how much the Bible has to say about forsaking and avoiding sexual sin. Isn't that still the biggest problem of the day? Look for solutions to the problems you face in your daily living. Make the Word of God, the sword of the Spirit, a daily impacting day, part of your day. It ought to matter more to your day than your... Are you listening to me, college students, high school, all of you? The Word of God is more important than your college. Are you ready? The Word of God, listen, is more important than your job. The Word of God is more important than your friends, than your social media. Take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. That's a fully prepared, completely equipped man of God, woman of God, taking on the whole armor of God. Let's all stand together. Our precious Lord and Heavenly Father, we sometimes will get into silly little battles.